It's a pleasure to introduce my former colleague, Professor Hein Daanen, with whom I worked together at TNO here in the Netherlands a very, very long time ago. Professor Daanen is Professor of Thermal Physiology at the MOVE Research Institute here in Amsterdam, Faculty of Movement Science. He's also a professor in Fashion Research and Technology at the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences, and he's still also working at TNO as Principal Scientist there. He's also director of the company Sizing Science, focusing optimization of garment fit. And if everybody has seen the orange shirts of all the helpers, they are sponsored by the company Sizing Science. So they all fit perfectly, of course. He has published widely, both in thermal physiology, but also in this other area of anthropometrics and sizing science, so in relation of how you should size clothing to match the population. So over to you, Hein.
Thank you for your kind words. Ladies and gentlemen, in this presentation I will focus on the more physiological aspects, and I will particularly discuss the adaptation of humans to cold and heat. First, I will briefly discuss the human responses to thermal extremes. What do we have physiologically? Then I'll talk about adaptation to cold. Can we adapt to cold? What mechanisms do we have? And does it have any effect on exercise? Thereafter, I talk about adaptation to heat, and I will focus not on acclimation, but I will focus on de-acclimation and re-acclimation. I'll explain later, but that is an area where far less research is done. And in the end, I will end with some conclusions and recommendations. If we summarize the human responses to cold and heat, then the first one, and that's addressed before, is the behavioral adaptations. Getting dressed differently, avoiding the heat, seeking the shade, and we are both convinced that this is the most important part. The physiological mechanisms that we have start with our ability to vasoconstrict and vasodilate. And it's mainly the blood vessels in the skin and the blood vessels in the muscles of the extremity that contribute to this. If the room is a little bit colder, then you will vasoconstrict in the skin and you will reduce your heat loss, because those blood vessels are in a fatty area. And especially the people that are overweight, it's a very successful technique to reduce heat loss. On the side of the heat, if we open our blood vessels, then it's a perfect way to increase our skin temperature and then release our heat. We have two additional mechanisms, one in the cold and one in the heat. When it's cold, we can increase our metabolism, we call that thermogenesis, and we have two parts, we have shivering and non-shivering thermogenesis. When it's very hot, we increase our sweat production, and in this way, we can, by evaporation of sweat, we can cool the skin. Let's first look at non-shivering thermogenesis. There's a nice experiment done by Van Ooyen in 2005. What she did is she had people lying on a bed under a duvet, and then suddenly she removed the duvet. Here, at moment one, she removed the duvet. And immediately you see an increase in metabolism. At moment two, the shivering part starts. This is the electromyographic activity of the pectoralis muscle that is generally the first to start shivering. So the period in between one and two can be considered as the period of non-shivering thermogenesis. And if we look critically, then we see that there's an increase of about 15 watt. If you compare that to the heat that we are making right now, here in this room, the average that everyone is making is about 100 watt of heat. And the maximum, a good trained athlete can easily have more than 1500 watts of heat loss. So this places a little bit in perspective. 15 watt of non-shivering thermogenesis is not much. Let's go to shivering thermogenesis. This is a graph from Benzinger. Here you see on the horizontal axis, you see the core temperature. On the left side, it drops. Here you see different skin temperatures. And this is the metabolic heat production. In rest, it's about 85 watt, the basal production. And when you shiver maximally, that is with a cold skin and a cold core, we can generate about 370 watt of heat. So altogether, we can estimate that we have an extra capacity of about 300 watt of heat production due to shivering. In that case, you have to shiver really vigorously. It has to be very cold, or you have to have malaria. The same amount of values are measured during malaria. Now, let's compare that to the capacity that we have in the heat. When we produce more heat than we lose, we have to store it in our body core. And when the body core temperature goes up, you see that the sweat rate goes up, especially when we surpass a certain threshold. Everyone has an individual threshold for sweating, and when we surpass that threshold, it increases immediately. The sweat rate can be considerably and is especially high for those people that need it. The distance runners have better sweat capacity and better sweat production than the sprinters or than the untrained men. The maximum sweat rate that is reported in the literature was reported by Armstrong, and it referred to Alberto Salazar, a marathon runner, and he evaporated 3.7 liters an hour, which is similar to 2,500 watts of cooling. So our sweating capacity and our cooling capacity using sweat is really enormous. In summary, I think we can say that we have limited thermogenesis and insulation in the cold. Shivering thermogenesis is really minimal, and with shivering we have about 300 watt, and we have excellent cooling capacities in the heat. And this brings us to the concept that humans are tropical animals. And this is consistent with the fact that we only left Africa about 40,000 years ago. And this is very recent in our history, in the history of the Earth. There are not many animals that left the heat so recently. So we have hardly any mechanisms for cold, and we have good mechanisms for heat. But I think the picture is only complete when we include adaptation in that. Let's look at our capability to adapt to cold and heat. First, I have to make a distinction between two terms that are used very often, the terms acclimatization and acclimation. Adaptation is the more general term, but you can also have acclimatization to cold or acclimation to cold. The difference is, in definition, that acclimatization refers to adaptation in natural settings, and acclimation refers to changes in artificial settings. If I use a climatic chamber to induce differences, we generally use the word acclimation. And if we go to a hot area previous to the performance that we have to deliver, we call it acclimatization. Acclimatization can be risky. On the right side, you see the temperature curves of Beijing. And if you come there 2 weeks before the Olympics and it's 20 degrees centigrade, and you hope that you can get acclimatized, you may have bad luck if the actual performance takes place in a temperature of 30 degrees centigrade. However, we realize that it's very often not easy to do those acclimatization in very controlled conditions. The Dutch national soccer team, for instance, that is now performing in the heat, they did an acclimation procedure in Portugal. They hoped to have a hot temperature there. Unfortunately, it was not the case. So what they did is they increased the exercise intensity, and like the English, they also wore a little bit more clothing to get a little bit more of adaptation. So it can be risky. Let us look at the adaptations that we have to cold first. First, we make a distinction between general cold adaptation and peripheral cold adaptation. One is referring to the whole body, if we expose our whole body to cold all the time, and the other one is refined to only the arms and the feet. They have different mechanisms, and I separate them in this presentation. There's a review on cold adaptations by the French group of Launay and Savoret, and they think that we should look at three parameters. We should look at core temperature. When we acclimatize to cold and when the core temperature drops over time, we call it hypothermic adaptation. We can look at skin temperature. When the skin temperature drops, we can call it more insulation. That can be due to more fat, but it can also be due to more vasoconstriction. And we can also look at metabolism. If the metabolisms increase, then we call it metabolic adaptation. And if it decreases, it's hypometabolic. In their review, they mainly based it on population studies, and they observed that the main adaptations are metabolic. People that live in cold areas have a higher metabolism, some insulative, and a nice insulation about insulative that did observe changes was a study from Imamura in Japan. She had a large group of females, and before the cold Japanese winter, she split them in two groups. One had to go through the cold Japanese winter in miniskirts, and the other half of the ladies had to go through the cold Japanese winter in long skirts. She measured the thickness of the fat in the leg before and after the winter, and she observed that the ladies that had a miniskirt had a thicker fat layer in spring than the ladies that were wearing long skirts. So again, a small indication that insulation may increase in the cold. Other report that changes are hypothermic. You get a lower core temperature, you can tolerate lower core temperatures, and there's a combination possible. Now let's look in more detail at the studies that are done more recently to look at this. This is a recent study that focused on adaptation to non-shivering thermogenesis. In this study, 19 humans were exposed to cold for 10 days. It was 15 degrees centigrade for 6 hours a day, so in air. They observed that there was an increase in non-shivering thermogenesis, and it's mainly related to the occurrence of more brown fat. Brown fat is an important source of non-shivering thermogenesis. However, if we look at the amount of increase, it's about only 4%. So if we look at the magnitude, then it's only about 1%. So here we see a metabolic adaptation that is only restricted in size. Let's look at more severe cooling. And this is a recent study in 2014 done by a group in Lithuania that cooled people for 14 males. And they immersed them in water every day until they had a core temperature of 35.5 degrees centigrade with a limit of 170 minutes. And they did that for several days. This was the starting day. Then they had 15 days of immersions here. And here were the final measurements to see if some changes occurred. Generally now they use water to get cold acclimation because water takes away the heat much more easily than air. Air is an insulator, so if you really want to cool people and you use air, it's almost impossible. You have to have water. Let's look at the results. In the upper right graph, you see the time that they spent in the cold water. And every day, the time became shorter. In the end, there are some changes because there was a day in between. But you see that the cooling was getting faster and faster. The time until the 35.5 was reached was getting increasingly less. What you can also see here is that there are some changes in metabolism. This is the metabolism in watt per square meter surface area. The first day it was about 160, and the last day that was measured it was less. So there seemed to be a hypometabolic adaptation also. People are generating less heat. Then there was one other aspect, and that's the comfort aspect. They were feeling less cold. So they were cooling more quick, they were feeling less cold, and they had a hypometabolic acclimation. Now let's see if this kind of acclimation can be of benefit if we have to exercise in the cold. And there are only two studies that looked at that. And this is the last one from Stocks in 2001. They also had an acclimation procedure over 15 days. They had a pre and post test for 16 minutes in cold water, and after that they cycled for 1 watt per kilogram, so it was light exercise. In between they had 15 days, 90 minutes a day in cold water. Again they found hypometabolic adaptation. That's what you can see here. This is the oxygen uptake. This is the first day, and this is after the adaptation in rest, so they're producing less heat. But during exercise, there was no difference. So there seems to be no benefit of cold acclimatization for exercise in the cold. And that was the same as the other study, which was from Tipton in 1998. Now let's look at local cold adaptations, because for general cold adaptations, there's not to be much to be gained. But in cold adaptations, people are generally very enthusiastic. In the handbook of physiology from Astrand, it is stated that when a person, whether an Arctic native or otherwise, allows his or her hands to be repeatedly exposed to cold for about half an hour daily for a few weeks, this cold stress increases the blood flow through the hands so that they will remain warmer and are not so apt to become numb when exposed to cold. So there seems to be very good peripheral adaptation to cold, and this is also stated by the review of Loney and Savouret, This local cold adaptation is probably the most interesting cold adaptation from professional activities point of view. So very enthusiastic. Now let's look at it. These statements are mainly based on one study in 1961 from Nelson Soper. What they observed in fish filleters that were working with cold fish every day, they observed that the fish filleters had a much better blood flow in the fingers. And they said in their abstract, this difference is considered to show the characteristics of acclimatization, and the fact that filleters are accustomed to working with their hands in very cold water is considered to be the stress producing the acclimatization response. However, they did not consider that some people may only become a fish filleter when they always have warm hands. So there may well be selection instead of any adaptation. So that's why we did a study here in Amsterdam, in which we asked 16 subjects to immerse their right hand and right foot every day, 30 minutes daily, for 15 days in 8 degrees centigrade water. And we had the other foot, the left one, the left hand and left foot, we only did that the first day and the last day as a kind of control. Here you see a subject sitting with a hand in ice water and feet in cold water, 8 degrees centigrade water. The results that we found were very small but significant. We found a small increase in toe temperature, and we found a small but significant decrease in finger temperature. The fingers were getting 0.5 degrees colder, and the toes were getting 0.5 degrees warmer. We also observed that there was a strong decrease in the pain experienced when you immerse your hand and feet in cold water. If you look at the fingers specifically, then the fingers become colder over time with less pain. And this is not what you really want, because it means that you have a higher risk for cold injuries. You have less feeling, and there's no increase in blood flow. In a recent review that we wrote together with Stephen Chung, we confirmed these observations when we looked at the literature critically. There's another study here from Mekiewicz that showed that the decrease in a protective reaction against cold, cold-induced phase dilation it's called, is reducing over time. So again, it's concluded that repeated local cold exposure does not alter the circulatory dynamics in the peripheries. So it may have been selection instead of real adaptation. So in conclusion, in the cold, we have no adaptation, general adaptation, and there seems to be also no local cold adaptation. This is the summary. The general cold adaptation, people cool faster, they generate less heat and they feel less cold, and it's not seen in exercise, it doesn't have any benefit for exercise. And local cold acclimatization, we found that the fingers are getting colder and less sensitive. And this is not really what you want. Now let's look at acclimation to heat. In heat, they observe very nice effects. This is an old study from Striden, who exposed people for 12 days to the heat, and they asked them to do the same amount of exercise each day. The first day, the sweat rate was about half a liter an hour. And after about 10 days, the sweat rate more than 1 liter an hour, the first hour of exercise. So this is really an enormous adaptation. At the same time, and this is what you could expect, you also see a sharp decrease in heart rate. For the same amount of exercise, the first day, the heart rate was over 160, and it dropped to about 130 when you're completely acclimatized or acclimated to heat. So this seemed to be very effective. Here on the left side, you see a summary of the observed effects. When you do the same exercise before and after acclimation to heat, then you see that after acclimation, the core temperature is much lower. You see that there's more sweating, a better skin blood flow, a lower metabolic rate, and a much lower heart rate. Heart rate is actually the first one to change. It's the most sensitive parameter for acclimatization. All these changes do not occur at the same time, but there is a fixed time flow for these acclimatizations. These adaptations also extend to a moderate climate. And there's a nice recent study from Lorenzo, 2010. What they did is they acclimatized people to heat, and they asked people to do the same exercise in a normal temperature. And then after that period, they asked them to do exercise in hot and cool conditions. So this is the acclimated group, and this is the non-acclimated group. They were well-trained subjects, so after that training period, there was no change in performance This is the time trial work done, no change in performance. And if you look at the heat acclimatized group, the performance is better in the heat, but it's also better in the cold. Cold here at 13 degrees centigrade, that's what they had. So there seems to be a positive cross-acclimatization effect also to performance in the cold. So heat acclimation seems to be very effective, and that's also why the recommendation, this is a statement from Taylor and Cotter, they say it's recommended that athletes live in the heat, experience heat under the pressure of competition, that has to do with behavior, what the previous speaker covered, acclimate for a specific climate, and then undertake high quality training in the cool. It is possible that when you train in extreme heat, that the stimulus may be insufficient to get any adaptation, similar when you train at very high altitude. This has hardly been researched, but I think it's good to make that exception here. There is a certain threshold to get acclimatization to heat. The best way to do it, and that it's controlled hypothermia, so that means that you maintain your core temperature higher than 38 degrees centigrade. You have to do it for a fixed amount of time, generally more than 2 hours, and for enough days. I briefly addressed the issue what happens if the acclimatization is too short, and what happens if the recovery is insufficient. On the left side, you see some studies from Garrett. Every year wants to have full acclimatization in a period that is as short as possible. Especially the military, they acclimatize to heat, and it costs them a lot of money because they cannot go into theater before they are completely acclimatized. So everyone is looking for the shortest period. And Garrett showed with his group that 5 days may be sufficient in well-trained subjects to have acclimation effects. On the other hand, I recently tried a study in which I have elderly females and young females, and I tried it in 3 days, and that was not successful. So that was obviously too short. An interesting project was a study that we did about 2 years ago, in which we gave insufficient recovery during the acclimation period. We had 15 male subjects. They had 60-minute bicycle exercise in the heat at 45 degrees, 45% VO2 max. And then we did an incremental max test. So for almost 2 hours, they were very heavily loaded in the heat. The first 9 days were 35 degrees, 30% relative humidity, and then we added 3 days in 41 degrees centigrade. Some of them, we didn't allow them to sleep at home. Half of them slept in the heat also, so they had insufficient recovery. And we did a retest in the same temperature after 3, 7, and 18 days. And this is what we observed. On the horizontal axis, you see the day of acclimation, and on the vertical axis, you see the rectal temperature. This is the rectal temperature in rest, and this is the rectal temperature at the end of exercise. And what you generally observed in acclimation studies is that the rectal temperature at rest is quickly dropping. But here we saw that the rectal temperature at rest is stable. And only after 3, 7, and 10 days, there was a drop in rectal temperature. So it seems to be here that the adaptations occurred after the heat acclimation period. They were very stressed here. There was some acclimation with the maximal rectal temperature at the end of exercise. But you see an enormous drop here after. So it seems to be that the main adaptations here are done after the acclimation period instead of during, probably because the heat stress was too much. Now let's look at de- and re-acclimation. If you have acclimatization, it disappears over time. And in 1998, Pandolf wrote a review summarizing the data. There were only a very few studies available. The rule of thumb still currently is that de-acclimation is twice as slow as acclimation. So if you have 10 days for complete acclimation, they say take 20 days for complete de-acclimatization. But in this review, he showed that it depends on the variable. Heart rate, there was a 65% decay in 1 week. And after three weeks, the changes in heart rate, the beneficial effects, were almost gone. And for rectal temperature, there was a longer delay. There's almost no data available for de- and re-acclimation. That's why we did a study in 16 male subjects. We acclimatized them using treadmill exercise at 46 degrees centigrade, so an extreme heat. We did that for 10 days, and then we split the group. Half of the group came back after 12 days, and the other half of the group came back after 26 days. In this way, we were sure that in the period after acclimation and 26 days, they didn't have any acclimatization again. So we didn't want to come back. We wanted to see really at the amount of de-acclimation. And when they came back, we had 4 to 5 days of re-acclimation to see how quickly the adaptations that they've got were coming back again. I've shown there's a result here for two parameters. On the left side, there's rectal temperature, and on the right side, there's heart rate. If you look at rectal temperature, then you see that the changes here, the rectal temperature is dropping, and then when they come back, the first day, after 26 or 12 days, there's almost no difference, the rectal temperature is still as low. So all the adaptations that we had in rectal temperature are still there after 12 or 26 days. So nothing vanished. It's immediately there. And actually, during re-acclimatization, there was even a small further drop. Not significantly, but you see it was not increasing. Then if you look at heart rate, this is the heart rate. The heart rate 60 minutes after 60 minutes of exercise. This is the acclimation period again, and this is re-acclimation. You see that there's a drop in heart rate here. And then when they come back the first day, the heart rate at similar exercise is higher again. So here, part of the acclimatization has been vanished. But what you can see here is that re-acclimatization occurs really quick. So although part of it is gone, with terms of heart rate, the faster changing, it quickly comes back. So in conclusion, if we look at heat acclimation, we can say that acclimatization leads to impressive adaptations. We promote heat acclimation because you have more control instead of acclimatization or going to the climate. And sometimes people that go to the heat come to the climatic chambers to train. I hope I also showed that cool rest periods are necessary to optimally adapt to the heat. You can wait till later, but the best is to have cool periods in between. And then the last study showed that once adaptation to heat has been attained, the time that individuals may spend in cooler conditions before returning to a hot environment could be as long as 1 month without the need for extensive readaptation to heat. Only in a few days you have the status back. This was also very important for the Dutch soccer team. They went to Portugal several weeks before in order to acclimatize to heat. They had a re-acclimation procedure in Brazil in the heat, and that's how they hope to pick up their adaptations again. What are the implications of these studies? I try to formulate some take-home message. The first one is, if you prepare for performance in the heat, it's good to invest in heat acclimatization. However, we have to make one note, and I think we should do more research there, that optimal performance may not always correspond to optimal heat adaptation. I think there should be more work done in that area. If we prepare for optimal performance in the cold, if, for instance, we plan to run the marathon of the North Pole or the South Pole, I don't think it's very good to invest in cold adaptation, to immerse yourself every day in cold water. Because what you see is you can have a better cold perception, you feel less cold, but the chances of cold injuries increase. And the cold injury can be either central, it can be hypothermia, but it can also be an increased risk for local cold injuries because there is no increased blood flow in the fingers. And there's an interesting thing popping up after the study I showed you. Maybe we should invest in heat acclimation in order to perform better in the cold, because the effects of heat acclimation also seem to extend to a more moderate climate. However, there's also one study that looked at that until now, that I know of. And if I summarized it, and I mentioned the term tropical animals in the start, I want to come back on that, and I think we're even more tropical animals than we thought before, because we have almost no adaptation to cold, it's very minimal, and we have perfect adaptation to the heat. So maybe in 100,000 years from now, we will be cold adapted because we live here. On the other hand, we are so, by behavioral adaptation, so trained to change our garments and to adapt to cold. There's not many people that expose themselves to cold voluntarily because they're so uncomfortable. So maybe we will stay tropical animals even for the coming 100,000 years. This concludes my presentation. I want to thank you for your attention, and I have one other take-home message. There are still polos available at the desk, especially the large sizes, and if you're a supporter of soccer, it would be very nice to look the game tomorrow in that orange polo shirt. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hein. There's time for some questions. Any questions from the room? If I may start, sort of give you some time perhaps to think about things. One of the things that I remember from the literature that I thought was one of the few things that I see as cold adaptations that are beneficial is a study, I think it's done by Livingston, with soldiers. So they exposed soldiers for a very long time sleeping in tents. And I think you could possibly, in terms of sports, link that to adventure racing and things like that. And the big advantage they found over, I think, a period of 3 to 6 weeks is that after about a week, the big advantage they found was that they didn't have to go outside each night for to go to the toilet, which is a very simple thing, but it means the diuresis is less after a period. So that could be an advantage in the long term. Have you come across something like that?
Yes, I think that's linked to the improved thermal comfort also. It must be very difficult to fall asleep when you're not, when you're feeling comfortable, especially the feet are well known. If you have cold feet, it's very difficult to fall asleep. And that adaptation is one of the few that I can consider useful. There's another example that refers to the Aboriginals in the desert. They have very cold nights and warm days. And also there it's observed that they can tolerate lower core temperatures, which is very beneficial for their sleep during the night. So I agree with you that may be an advantage.
Okay. I think there's a question over here.
Neil Maxwell from University of Brighton. You mentioned one of the studies that the females didn't adapt in 3 days, but they were also elderly. Which do you think was the reason that they didn't adapt?
Thank you for this question. In the elderly females, we had a big problem we had elderly and we had younger females. Comparison. For the elderly females, we had a big problem that after 1 hour of exercising in the heat, they were completely exhausted. And you need 2 hours to have them acclimatized. So the time exposed in the heat was too short, I think we should look at acclimatizing in the heat without exercise. Because even then the temperature can go up, or very light exercise. We had 1 watt per kilogram of exercise. About 60, 70 watts we had for them, and that was even too strenuous for them. So I think that the reason why they did not acclimatize in 3 days, also it was very short, was that they had insufficient long period in the heat. The idea behind trying to acclimatize elderly to the heat is that when there is a heat wave in the Netherlands, the elderly wait in fear till the heat wave comes, and then you see a lot of people that are getting sick or that die. So the idea was to have controlled in the elderly homes, to have a controlled period of acclimation when a heat wave is occurring, so that they could adapt to the heat. But obviously 3 days is too short, and the time should be longer indeed. So I think that's the explanation.
Okay, if I see it right, I think that's Juha Oksa in the back.
Yes, thank you, Hein, very good presentation. Could you comment a little bit about the individual differences in the capability of adapting to cold? Because I remember one study that we made where people were exposed for 2 hours to 5 degrees, and there was a heavy shivering after 45 minutes or so, but one of the subjects fell asleep after 1.5 hours.
Yes, I think I didn't cover that here. There were all group studies that were done here, but the individual variation is enormous, and it links also very much to the body build. If, for instance, one of our experiments, we tried to cool subjects in cold water, and there was one subject that had a good insulative layer, to say it this way, and it was impossible to get her core temperature down, even after 2 hours. So the insulation layer, I think, plays a very important role. It's nice to see also that people have two ways to react to cold. You can distinguish into two parts. One group has the tendency to increase thermogenesis, and one group has the tendency to, not to increase thermogenesis, but to vasoconstrict a lot, because those are the two options. There's a very nice study by Van Marke Lichtenbelt. What he did is he exposed people to cold. He compared the two groups, and those subjects that had the tendency, were young subjects, to increase heat production, they were also the one that had less tendency to become obese. And I think there's line in that. So it may be a very simple test to test obesity, and it illustrates the enormous variation there is in response to cold.
Okay, I think it's Sebastian over here.
Thank you. Sebastian Racine from Qatar. You did a very nice study on re-acclimation, and I was wondering if you have any physiological data on that. For example, were the participants still having a plasma volume expansion after 1 week or 2 weeks of de-acclimation?
Well, that's a very nice question. Unfortunately, we did not measure the plasma volume. We do have body weight, but that's not a very good parameter. We have no real plasma values there in both studies that I mentioned, unfortunately.
Any other questions? I've got another one. Hein, you talked about acclimatization, different temperature and different loads. There's also, I think, some work done by Griefan in Germany on cross-acclimatization between warm, wet, and hot, dry, which, of course, if we think about Qatar versus Brazil, is quite an interesting topic. Do you have any views on that?
Yes, the study of Griefan, if I remember well, she had two different climates, hot, dry, and warm, humid, with similar WBGT. WBGT is an indication of the thermal load on the body, and she found no difference in acclimation there. And I agree on that. However, if you look at de-acclimation, then there seems to be differences. I don't know if I can go back a little bit more. But in the overview of Pandolf, but it's only for, they found a greater attention to dry heat. So in acclimation, Griefan study found no differences, but there may be difference in de-acclimation. But again, there's such a limited amount of data, it refers to one study only. I think it will be very difficult to substantiate it. We need a little bit more data. But that is what is available at this moment.
Okay, thank you. As far as I can see, no more questions. So I would like to thank both speakers for their talks, and thank you for coming.